fully committed. Everything, right? Everything about what you were doing was just in the music and hearing, not thinking about anything else, which is wonderful. What would really want for her? And we'll talk about stylistic things in a minute. Yeah.
She was so wonderfully expressive. And like, it wasn't over the top. It really fit with the piece. I mean, it made me really want to try and sing well for her.
Yes, because of the level of commitment mm-hmm. and how invested she was in making the music mm-hmm. and the phrases and everything. Yeah,
I remember what you said, so I jumped on soprano. Mm-hmm. But it was like, even in not being not great voice, it was much easier to sing for you because your playing was in such a supportive place for breath the whole time. So like, even though we were all recite reading and everything, it went really well because you were just providing us with like the basic mechanics to sing well. So that was really nice.
I'm so glad you mentioned that because it reminds me of something I thought of as I was writing comments on your reviews, that sometimes we do get, you know, sometimes as Emily was asking last week, what if we do need to be a little higher just to be seen, just because, you know, placement or whatever. It's not always possible, and this definitely will, part of the reason that, you know, when Rod and others recommend if we're low, that actually changes the conductor's breath. Think about it. Be up here, right? And then if I think, it actually changes my breath. So if you're stuck, like sometimes, you know, you were quite high, but because rapport was active and you had that wonderful foundation, helped us to sing. So my first thought, there are two things about this edition. Well, many things. First of all, adagio. I mean, Cernici wouldn't have written that. Just to check all these early editions.
What's that? Sorry.
If you're going to sneeze, make it a good one. that's what I say. So not necessarily. I would maybe think about a four that is in a feeling of two to reflect harmonic rhythm. Mm-hmm. And you might even take it a little bit faster and disregard that adagio since that's editorial. And the other thing that Shijia and I were talking about via email is about ficta, right? Because in early music, music before 1600, there was a practice of putting accidentals where they were intended by the composer and in the performance practice and convention without notating them in the score. So that's why there are some differences in interpretation, especially, you know, the E naturals and things like that. So let's talk about the, how about if you felt it more in two, even if you want to do it in four, or you might even think about or try it in two. But what was the character that she was conveying of this music? I thought it was very fitting for that. Yeah.
Yeah, very thoughtful. Like, even when I was singing it, I was also listening to it. And if I was listening to this in a performance, I would really like think about each chord that we were singing because each one was really highlighted really nicely.
Yeah. So she really heard all the harmonies mm-hmm. and the colors, right? But the translation that you've been working on, and I have to hand it to you, you did a good job with the old French with this word for word. It's, so this one actually, it looks like cour, at the very last, but it's actually cour. I mean, it's not pronounced cour, but it's the old French for the, you know.
Because some translator, they can translate the
old
French sometimes.
Right, yeah, Google Translate doesn't do very well with old French. And the same thing for fleur, right, I don't think it's in your score as fleur. Is it flu?
Yeah,
it looks like flowers. Mm-hmm. Flower, but it's actually F-L-E-U-R-S, fleu, for the modern French. But you know, that was pretty good, made up the. the whole thought of this chanson is what? Like, what's the emotion?
Actually, Sam, the English translate, should I read it?
No, but no, just tell us what you think the emotion is.
It's more sadness.
Yes.
And
why? Why is the person sad?
He lost his love.
Yes.
So she lost her love. Sorry.
Well, we don't know. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there's all this more, you know, you're talking about eating the pears of sadness and going to, but it starts out talking about what? The beautiful, the pretty, the woods, right? So you have this scene. There's a lot of things that, so if that's my goal for you, is to think about the harmonic rhythm, keep the wonderful line that you have, and also let us see where there are certain words that you want to highlight that might be expressive, internal nuances, right? Like either ma or ke or wherever it falls in the phrase. Do you want to try it again with that in mind?
I actually tried two tempo. One is like 4-beat tempo, and can I try the 2-tempo?
Definitely, yes.
A bit two, and it's more fast, and I think it's better for a small group, actually.
So you're going to be in two.
Yeah, I'm in two now. Give yourself permission to not necessarily observe all of these dynamics for now. Just think, I mean, yeah, you can be informed, let those inform how you breathe, perhaps. But let's really go to the text. So how do the phrases relate to each other to make a large design when there's a repeated musical thought? How do we say it a different way based on the text? Does that make sense? Yeah.
The other thing is that start of, I think it's the third, I don't know where it is in your score, but it talks about the garden full of black flowers. That's, they have, I think the next page.
Page five.
Yes, page five, at rehearsal two. So, what kind of sound do you want there?
More. Yes.
What kind of, so she has a forte at that.
Actually,
time.
I changed the dynamic because the composer writes like two line or mezzo forte, but actually, from the text, the Tasmanian is in a garden filled with black flowers. That's the first line. And the second line, it turns to my two eyes will make tears and tears. So I actually think like the first line, we can seem more, not like strong, just more open and strong emotion, but not strong dynamic. And actually the second line, it changed to eyes with tears and tears. So I think it's more sadness, something. So I just turned down the dynamics.
Yeah, so it's this internalized grief, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
And in a garden, so if they start out in a garden, in a garden, right?
Yeah.
On the Jordan is really what we want to do. You want to just try before that and get into that?
Maybe from this page?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. So let's try from...
Right at reversal two?
Yes.
Or do you have reversal numbers?
Yeah,
no,
reversal number two.
Reversal number two. Not to tell them to fix anything, but in response to, and I heard that, in response to the gesture, like what did you hear from them? What kind of forte was that?
I just feel a little bit sudden.
Sudden,
uh-huh.
And it didn't have body, right?
Yeah.
It was more like, So make sure that you're following through. Like if you want an accent on the bottom, make sure that you follow through in your rebound so that they can really make that even if it's that it goes to Jean-Pierre, you have you leave yourself room
mm-hmm.
to go. So here's my next thought, right, is about the French. And I know that beep went off, but we do have a little bit of time. It's so great in French texted music to show accentuation. Like, top of rehearsal five, everybody. So it's j'endure, right? So instead of j'endure. So I would use sighs to show unstressed. Something that I write in my music constantly is that unstressed mark,
mm-hmm.
So that we can, you know, remember as conductors where something is not stressed, where there should be more lightness. Would you like to just try that last page?
Okay.
Oh,
poetry that you want this group of musicians to convey the story, the scene to the audience. Okay, so in terms of pacing, it, yes, we need to have a tonsus, but how would we speak that? Yeah, so how would you pace that to make it more reflective of the text? One more time. Mm-hmm. It's really beautiful, very expressive, wonderful openness. To make this whole page function together as one?
I actually think it's like, can I use a line to?
Yeah, you don't have to explain it. It's okay. Like you can just explain it with your
okay. Mm-hmm.
All right, once more, last time. The next round to think about the internal nuances within the phrase, like the small moments of meaning within each phrase,
yeah.
And then relate the phrases to each other to show us the large design or the story, or the scene. Right? We should be able to picture the beautiful words and those black flowers and the weeping eyes and the internalization of the hollowness at the very end. And play around with the pacing and all that. Yeah, Emily.
Can I just say, I think on the same track as that, I think part of the reason this tempo feels so much better for us is that the poetry is strophic. And so we can really hear the rhyme a lot better. Mm-hmm. And we can also hear big picture rhymes as well. So the last phrase, we can hear that it rhymes with the previous page. That the top of the last page is the same as the top of the previous page. And all of that structure, just, I think it works a lot better. And along the same, so the same question of, you know, how does this page hold together? I think aside from the text emphasis and like all of that, the sort of micro phrases within that line, it is just a list, right? Blah, 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 and then the last line, which rhymes with the previous page. So the more we can hear that, the more the big picture structure will really scan. And then the second thought I had is that sometimes in between the big, the end of a big phrase and the beginning of the next phrase, I think you begin breathing for the next phrase before you close the rebound of the former phrase. Mm-hmm. And I think that there are just a couple times we weren't quite with you because some of us are following the end of the phrase, and some of us are going with you into the new phrase.
Yeah.
So I look for that.
Great, great thoughts. And the whole thing about the rhyme, that's so beautiful. Yeah.
I love that, and that sparked an idea that when it's at this tempo, and we can hear the strophes and the different rhymes, it makes it so much easier to think of it in terms of macro meter, which I think will assist with the phrasing over the whole page. So
yeah.
To me, that just pops out as soon as you took it at that tempo.
Yes, it's that, but you know, we have all these layers, and you know, it's like zooming out
mm-hmm.
and zooming in. You know, sometimes at a certain amount of zoomed out, it really works.
Right.
Yeah, any other thoughts? Great ideas. Beautiful.